Hello everyone, welcome to Ilian and the Magic Box. Today on our show, we are going to have Bekin. Bekin is from Kosovo. So, let's see what Bekin has to say. Enjoy the interview.
Hello.
How are you, Bekin? How are you?
I'm good.
Should I call you Bex or Bekin?
Bekin is fine.
Bekin? Right, what are you drinking, Bekin?
Tea.
Amazing, amazing. Which kind of tea?
Assam. It's tea leaves always in my house, in a teapot properly.
Amazing. That's sweet. That's nice.
No tea bags.
Very good, very good. Okay, Bekin. So just before we start the game, just tell me, where are you from?
I'm originally from Kosovo, which is the youngest state in Europe, I think, still.
Okay, and what do you do for a living?
I work for local government, which is not glamorous at all.
Right, and what do you like the most about your job?
Especially at this time, I think the fact that I make sure that nobody is left unfed and unwashed. And I commission home care, so my responsibility is to make sure that people who are not able to look after themselves, they have enough, they have somebody to go in up to 4 times a day, sometimes even to stay overnight to make sure that they're all right. So I suppose I could take some points in that, but I don't do it myself, so, and I also get paid for it, so I can't say I'm such a good person, really, just doing my job.
Doing very well, that's for sure, that's for sure. Just tell me something interesting about Kosovo, about your country.
Oh, God. Kosovo is, I don't know, first of all, I don't know if I can be objective because I was born there and it has a very special place in my heart. And I have lived in the UK longer than I've lived there, so my identity is a little bit confused somewhat. The fact that I've cried for England more in football than Kosovo says a lot, so there you go. However, Kosovo is a small country, up to about 2 million people. It's landlocked. It's between Albania, Serbia, Montenegro and Macedonia. It's got beautiful mountains and it's got the best climate in the world because the summers are hot and the winters are cold. And the people are ridiculously friendly to the point that you feel so ashamed for not being as friendly as nice as they are. They never let you pay for anything if you go there as a visitor. And they are very young. So it's a very young population. It's the youngest population in Europe. So if you go to Pristina, for example, you think you're in Hagia Napa or somewhere, you know, but in a much calmer way because the country is quite perhaps a bit more traditional. So you don't get people drunk on the street with their, you know, legs up in the air and stuff like that. So they're all very well behaved. But they are very young and very fun-loving, and the cafes are absolutely full. And if you're foreign, they absolutely love you. And they just will do anything to show you around to the point that it's almost embarrassing sometimes.
Oh my God, that's amazing. Very interesting. Wow,
yeah, but then, as I said, I don't know if I can be objective because I'm from there. So there's two countries I can't be totally objective about, is Kosovo and England. So I always perhaps have two, you know, emotional attachments to both.
Cool, very good. Right, Bekin, so welcome to Ilian and the Magic Box. I have this lovely box here full of random fun questions, okay? So what am I going to do now? I'm just gonna play a music just for us to get in the mood before the first question. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Great, let's do it. Right, Bekin, ready for the first question?
Yeah.
Let's do it. So the first question is, would you rather be invisible or be able to fly, and why?
I would rather be able to fly, I have to say. Being invisible, I would be too tempted to sneak into places that I'm not supposed to be. And I'm very aware of people's privacy, and as I like to my privacy safe, I wouldn't want to infringe on other people's privacy. As an invisible person, I would be very tempted to do that. So none of that. Flying is another matter. I would absolutely love to fly. I love the perspective from above and just to see how everything is. I was a strange child anyway when I was little. I had a fascination with chimneys. Like, I was always getting on top of the roof to play with the chimneys, because in Kosovo we have these chimneys that they move with the wind.
Right.
So I was making sure that they were all oiled and they're moving and they're not making noises and stuff. So it's a bit strange. So I do like heights, put it that way.
Oh, wow. Let's say
if you... From a bird perspective, I think I like.
Let's say that from today you could be able to fly. Where would you go right now? Where would you go if you could be able to fly?
Good. That's a very good question. I would like to go to Cairo.
Why is that?
I think I've always wanted to go there. There's three cities I really want to see, and it's unfortunate that at the moment I can't. It's Cairo, Damascus, and Jerusalem. I'm into history and all that business, so that part of the world is incredibly interesting historically and culturally. And I think it's amazing to see. Cairo is relatively close to Europe, but it's also so far in so many other ways. And as a flying person, I think it would be so much easier to overcome those barriers that are between us at the moment. I didn't on purpose want to say Damascus because of the implication of what's going on there. I don't want to go like seeing some kind of... It's awful what's been going on. And it's one of the cities... It's the oldest capital city in the world that has been inhabited continuously for almost 3,000 years. And of course, I'd like to go and fly over there, but at the moment, it's very sad. So I didn't want to say Damascus, because it's like you're going to some kind of a zoo or something. So
you'd go to Cairo instead.
I'll go to Cairo instead, and Jerusalem if I can, if I have time, if you let me.
Very good. Let's go for another question. Let's do it, Becky. Right, let's get another question. Becky, next question is, what will be your theme song if you had your own show?
That's easy. Pump Up the Jam from Technotronic. That's going to be in for my funeral as I go into the incinerator. Do you know the one? Pump Up the Jam. It's my favorite song. That's when my taste changed from hard rock to dance music. It was early 90s, I think, and it was quite embarrassing because I was in the dining room and all my family were in the living room, and we had frosted glass. I forgot that they all could see what I was doing in the dining room. So the song went on the radio and I started dancing, and I came and I opened the door and my family were like looking. They had never seen me show that kind of happiness in their lives.
Oh my God.
And they just went like, and I said, oh, they go like, you were dancing. And I said, so all my friends know that when the day comes, which is going to be long from now, as I go into the special box to go into the flames, they're going to have to play that. Pump up the jam, pump it up.
I'll tell something now, Becky. Actually, I've been using this song to play during my show, and I'm ready for the third question.
Yeah,
let's do it. Next question, Bekim, let's do it. If you could have tea with a fictional character, who that would be and why?
One of the sons of Karamazov brothers.
Why?
The old one. Because it's one of the most beautiful books ever written, I think. And the relationship between the three brothers, it's amazing. Amazing is not the right word, what would I say? It's so kind of surreal, and they're brought up by this really weird guy. And all three of them, they turn out so different from each other. And there is this point where they all meet up. And I read it when I was about 18, so it's a long time ago. I'm 51 now. So they all meet up to discuss kind of their life, I suppose, how it all turned out. And the conversation they have is one of the best dialogues ever written in literature. And although Dostoevsky was kind of a Russian nationalist, which I normally don't agree with, but his writing is beautiful and his characters are just spot on. He's just like, and one of the sons, yeah, the older son, I'd love to meet him and to ask him, what was it like to have a dad like that?
Very good, very good. Let's get another question for you. Yeah. Let's do it. I'm going to remember you now all the time when I listen to this track. That's for sure. That's for sure.
I'm glad you think.
Next question is, if you were on a circus, which character would you like to be and why?
Hang on, let me. I would be the trapeze guy. You know, right. The one that goes up and down the trapeze and stuff, because it's so opposite of my skill. Right. So I'd love to be able to do those kind of things, those tricks and just flying and the somersaults and, you know what they do. All sorts of this acrobatic, is that trapeze? What do you call them?
Acrobatics, isn't it?
Acrobatics, yeah. I mean, I'd love to be able to do that at least once. To be so light and to just to be able to kind of somersault and do all sorts of things. Because, as I said, I am totally the opposite. I have no sporty, physical type skills at all. Which is a bit of a shame.
Let's go for another one. Right. What do you like to cook the most?
I cook a lot and I cook all sorts of things. What do I like to cook the most? Because I cook Albanian food, I cook, when I say Albanian, that's Kosovo, you know, because ethnically we are Albanian. I cook modern food. Ooh, that's it. I should have a ready answer to that because I really like cooking. I would say I still love to cook the stuffed cabbage leaves, which I did for Christmas. It's very traditional winter food back in Kosovo when it's like minus 25 degrees outside. Not very often, but it does get up to that cold. And all you want to do is just eat that. And it's made with mincemeat and rice and with pickled cabbage. And it's great. I mean, when I make it here, I made it for Christmas. I had 3 days of it. Because I live on my own, so on purpose I make so much, so I can eat about 3 days. But I like everything. I love making gratin dauphinois, for example, which is very simple. I love getting my steak right. Yeah, 2.5 minutes.
Are you more or less a sweet person or a savory person?
No, not sweet. Salty, sour, everything. Not so much sweet. I'm trying to develop. Although I did work and I still am. One of my best friends owns the best patisserie in London, which is Maison Berthaud in Soho. So I do have a good taste for patisseries, but somehow give me salty things anytime. And alcoholic ones, hopefully.
Let's get another question. Let's do it.
You can't sit down for this.
I know. Next question is, would you ever get a tattoo and why that would be?
I wouldn't, because I just don't have the body for it, I think. I'd love to get probably a quotation from Plato in original Greek. I was thinking at some point of getting some a text in original font in Greek. I can read Greek, but I can't speak it, unfortunately. But I won't do it because I'm just a bit old now.
I mean, never too old. You don't need to have a body to have a tattoo. You can have a tattoo.
Have a body. Like, I don't know. I'm not very much. I think I've missed that boat has sailed, as they say in English.
Right. Another question for you. Let's do it, Becky. Question is, who was your favorite teacher at school and why?
My favorite, my first ever teacher was called Javad Bajiri, and he was just one of the most amazing teachers ever. Back the way the system works in Costa Rica is from age six to age, that's 4 years, to about 10, you have the same teacher. And he taught us pretty much everything. And recently I had to teach my goddaughter Roman numbers, and I remember them still. Oh. I learned Roman numbers when I was 9. And it was so amazing that I still could remember them, and I could explain them, how they work, the logic. And that was exactly, I had the picture of my teacher in front of me, how he explained us, and little things that they used to tell us, for example, which were outside the curriculum. So he would say things like, you know, when the days start getting longer or shorter in the summer and winter, he would say, the time the day is longer every day, it's exactly the time that it takes for the rooster to jump from one bean to another. That's if that amazing. Makes any sense. That's in amazing. Albanian, it kind of makes a bit more sense, because like the way that maybe the beans are, let's say, this far from each other. So he would stop and he says that's how the day gets longer. I'm not sure if that's scientifically true though, but it's stuck in here. And plus he just took us everywhere. All the other teachers were just so boring. They would take on a picnic day, they would take people in the local park. You know, we had a park in the town where we grew up, which was a quite nice park. But he would take us to the mountains because we are surrounded by very big, huge mountains. And he would take us to these trips for the whole day, not rather than just 2 hours, just to get a bit of an exercise like other teachers were doing. So a lot, I have to thank him a lot for kind of getting us to think outside the usual kind of, you know, way that we were meant to do, especially in growing up in the Eastern sort of communist country, you know, although Yugoslavia was never that strict, but, you know, we did have this kind of ideological upbringing, education, but he avoided that as much as he could. He taught us real things. He wasn't telling us about revolutions and Marx and Karl, you know, all this stuff. So, yeah.
Very good. You know what? My first teacher as well, actually, she was my favorite teacher like ever. I was so crazy to go to school. I remember my very first day at school. I never forget that because I was so excited. I remember holding hands with my colleagues to go to the classroom. And actually, I met her afterwards. She was just the first year with me, and I remember she was pregnant at the time, and she left halfway of the year school. And I remember I was so like brokenhearted at the time. My God, I remember. And to be honest to you, when I was 18, before I moved to Portugal, when I was 19, before I was 18, I was working McDonald's in the capital of my state. And when I was a very small city, so I was in the capital, like far away, and I was working McDonald's. And I remember I was tuning the computer, and suddenly she came to order something, and it was my first job. And I remember she looked at me, I looked at her, I was like, oh my God. She was like, what happened? I said, oh my God, is your name Ladislen? She was like, yes. I said, you were my first teacher. She was like, oh my God, that was amazing.
I know, you simply can't forget your first teacher, I think. Luckily for me and you, it seems we both had very good teachers, but sometimes it's not always the same story for everyone. But my first day was a nightmare because I was so shy and I wouldn't let my mother leave the classroom.
Oh my God.
Oh, it's so embarrassing. I can't believe I actually did. At the moment she started to go, I would go with her, and that is just not how I am at all. I mean, I'm not a mummy's boy at all. I was not even then. So I don't know where that came from. And I still don't want to think about the first day. but the day from day two is okay, I think.
And I remembered as well. I remember telling her, I said, I told her, and you left us halfway off, we finished school. She was like, oh my God, I remember that. I was pregnant. And guess what? And she said to me, this, she was like, they had like a tall girl like by her side, and she was like, that's the reason why I left. It was this massive like girl. I was like, oh my God, it was amazing. It was just amazing to meet her. Like,
I it's so good that you ran into her. That was unplanned, right?
It was just it wasn't. Literally, it's a big city actually. It was McDonald's, and it was like this city. It's like 2 million people in the city. And literally, she just came up this in this exact point when I was working, you know? So I was like, oh my God.
Yeah. She just turned up as your customer.
Yeah, just like that.
Yeah. It's just, those moments are just so amazing, I think, in a city. I mean, and it even happens in London, 8 million people. And absolutely. I have run into people I went to school with who's like, what are you doing here? He's like, yeah, what are you doing here? You know, so life is full of surprises, I think.
Good. Becky, are you enjoyed the show so far?
Great, yeah.
Very,
very, very much so. I hope I'm not talking too much. Because I do talk a lot. I'm completely aware that that's one of my faults.
Don't worry. Let's get another question for you.
I can ask my colleagues about that as well.
You are in the right place. You are in the right place. Just talk. We need to talk a lot. Get more information I can from you from the questions. Let's do another one. Okay. Let's get another question for you. The next question is, in your opinion, what do you consider to be relationship deal breakers?
I think trust is one of the main ones, I think, for me anyway, and integrity. Is it just have to be one thing? Because I think it's never just one thing. It's so many.
No, deal breakers. Like, in your opinion,
For me, it's trust, humor. Being able to laugh with somebody, it's so important. And the initial infatuation when you start going out with somebody, like, let's say in the first 3 years, even if you're lucky, it's not going to last. The whole, like, we just want to bonk each other all to death all the time. That's not going to go. That's not going to last forever. But having that kind of soul connection with somebody, being able to laugh with somebody is one of the most amazing things. Because that is, I think I read it somewhere when it says, like, being in love with somebody is not looking at each other, it's looking in the same direction. Which is a bit cheesy, but I think it's quite true. So if you look in the same direction, it normally means that you are soulmates, or you really
agree
on each other's views, and you know.
Sure.
Yeah.
Ready for another one?
Yeah.
Let's do it. Wait, next question is, what scares you the most about your future?
I am not really scared, generally, as a person. I'm very optimistic and la 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 la, the rest of it. I don't want to, like, bore you to death about that. But I am more worried about the world. I'm worried about... Often I have caught myself thinking, I'm glad I don't have children, because I'm not sure what kind of world we're leaving to them. Our generation and our parents' generations, I think we've had it very well. But we have two massive problems now that we're dealing with. Climate change, which is massively, we can see what's going on. But also politically, I think some very dark forces are coming out. The rise of the right-wing extremism and fascism is obvious in so many countries. I am completely opposed to Brexit, by the way. I am very political. I have been shouting ever since for 5 years now. I hate nationalism, and all those things are creeping back into the narrative, especially in the West. And it scares me what the future is. And when this COVID started and lockdown and stuff, I was my nature makes me think about positive things, like, oh, maybe we learn something else, because obviously capitalism is failing. We are living in a system that it doesn't sustain itself. We are in debt into people who just generate numbers from computers, you know. So the whole system is flawed. And I was thinking, oh, maybe we will learn something. And I am not sure if we are learning, to be honest. And that's, I don't know if I would say that would scare me. It's just something that worries me about the future.
wow, what an answer. My God, you know a lot about politics. I love it. I love it. I love it. I just love it. No, I like it. I like it.
I told people to death about politics.
No, that's amazing. I wish I had like at least 10% of that to know. My God, that's amazing. I love it. I love your answer. Very good. Very good, Vicky. Thank you very much for sharing that. Thank you. Right. Another question. Let's do it. Make my day. Right, next question is, if someone offered you to tell you your future, would you accept it and why?
No.
Why?
I don't want to know what happens in the future. I think because it would kill the present.
Good point.
It could potentially, if it's bad, no. I think there's another thing that I live by is if you worry about the past, you become depressed. If you worry about the future, you become anxious. So just live the moment.
Let's live the present. Let's live
carpe
the moment.
Diem, carpe diem, as they said in Latin, and you know, and just live for the moment. Be as silly as you can, and I guarantee you'll be happy.
Very good, Vicky. Very good point.
Silliness is my mantra.
No, I love it. Very good. I totally agree with you. I have 3 questions left for you. Let's do it.
Hey, bon.
Okay. Before the next question, let's say if I tell you now, okay, Becky, I'm going to Kosovo tomorrow. What advice you give to me, like to go to what is advice, anything that's okay, you should do that or you should
absolutely. Kosovo is, you have to try as much food as you can and try not to go to pizzerias because they're quite popular. Pizzerias is not traditional food. You have to ask for traditional Kosovan food, and Albanians are big foodies. They like 3 times a day they cook, you know. Our food is similar to Greek and Turkish, if you've ever been either of those. So it's not very different or original. So it's in that area, like think Greek, think Turkish, but we don't put lemon in everything like Greeks do, because we don't have lemons, it's cold. So, food is one. Try to see as many bars, and it's a very vibrant nightlife in the summer, especially. In the winter, it could be a bit cold because, as I said, it could go up to minus 15, you know, it can get quite cold. So that, to see mountains, like I would say this because I'm from there, Pea is the second or maybe third city. It's the most western city from Pristina, which is the capital. And there, the view is amazing, and the kind of ski center, I suppose, it's called Borge, which is about half an hour up in the mountains, and it's absolutely gorgeous there. It's really beautiful, and at the moment they've got 1 meter snow, it looks so kind of like in fairy tale-ish kind of thing. So I would go, but historic sites, you'd have to see all the medieval churches and monasteries, which go back to the medieval Serbian state. Then you have, in every city of Kosovo, you have the old part of town, which is a mixture of Byzantine and Turkish architecture, beautiful mosques and churches everywhere you go to. I'm not religious, but I like the buildings. And if it's winter, I would suggest you go skiing in Brezovica, which is not the one I was talking before. This is a proper ski center, like a official ski center, which is in the south. But it's very small. Kosovo is very small. You can see everything in 3 days. It's the size half of Wales.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Very small country.
Right. Next question is, what is your all-time favorite band and why?
Oh God, I listen to a lot of music, man. Eurythmics.
Cool.
Here comes the rain again. coming on my head like a tragedy.
Very good, very good.
I have so many others. I mean, I don't know where to start. I mean, that just popped up now, but I do like a lot of music.
Right, Baking, two questions left for you. Let's do it. Okay, next question is, what's the best gift have you ever received and from whom?
It's a cuckoo clock from my friend Daniel. It's here actually, I don't know how to show it. It's on the wall.
Okay.
One of my really good friends is that he's Swiss, he lives in Switzerland, and we lived in our 20s in London. We shared a flat for 4 years. And I told him the strange story when I was a kid. I was just a weird kid. Like, instead of liking football, I like chimneys and clocks and sewing machines. And I've got a sewing machine here as well. So actually, I will share that with also another beautiful gift I got. One for my 40th, one for my 50th. One is a sewing machine, which is...
Oh, that's sweet. Oh, that's nice.
And then also the cuckoo clock. Which is, I'll show it to you. Is this here? Can you see it?
Oh, that's sweet. That's beautiful. Yes, again.
I told them this story that when I was little, I was just weird. I was a strange child. I thought anything that is mechanical. And I had a fascination with cuckoo clocks and sewing machines and locks and things like that. And they remembered it. So he, for my 50th, he sent me this clock, which now goes tick, 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 tick. It annoys a lot of people.
Oh, that's
twice a day I have to wind it. So, it gives, you know, in lockdown, that gives you something, it's like a routine. I have to wind the clock up.
Oh, that's sweet. I like that. Very good. Yeah. Ready for the last question, Bikin?
Yeah.
Let's do it. Let's go. This music now is going to be stuck in my head for the whole day now.
Oh, it's always in my head.
Okay.
There's so many mixes of it. Have you noticed? If you go out not dancing, there's so many versions of it. If you go out, depending whichever music you like, and you go out dancing and clubbing when we used to, there's versions of this.
Absolutely. Last question, Baking. What would be your ideal day?
Anything that involves historical things, like take me to a ruin anytime. I'm happy. You know, take me, like, when I went to Pompeii, I was so amazed. I got lost and it shut down. I was left in the middle of Pompeii. All the lights went out in the darkness. And I was locked in an ancient city, not knowing how to get out. Yeah, so I'd love to do that. I'd love to go to Jerusalem. So, or Cairo. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That would be your
historical. I think for me, I get so transported into. I sometimes feel like the walls can talk to me, which is a bit mad. You think?
No.
I can have a conversation with the walls and the battles and who was there and who built it and what happened there and why they came and then there's Saladin came and then King Richard came and, you know, for me it's all like a film. So any historic sites, I'm happy.
Very good. Very good. Okay, Baking, it's not the end yet. Okay, let's play now the quick thinking game. So I'm going to give away some words and you just tell me one thing that comes to your mind, okay? Quick thinking.
Right,
ready?
Right. I'm not a cookie. Okay, go on.
Right, let's start with religion.
Bullshit.
Love?
I don't know. It's there somewhere.
Okay. How about money?
Bullshit.
Family?
Most important thing.
Life.
Beautiful.
Sex.
Oh, sex! Great. How can you not have sex?
Okay. Politics.
It necessary.
Okay. How about fear?
Also necessary.
Good one, very good. Friendship?
Totally necessary. The most precious thing. I did say that about family. Sorry.
No. About desire.
Desire is is fuel.
Okay. Regrets.
opportunity to improve, maybe? I don't know.
Okay. Wish.
Wish. Part of life.
Okay. And if I tell you United Kingdom, one word.
Great.
And the last one now, Kosovo.
Hard.
Oh, that's nice, that's sweet. Okay, Bekin, so now let's pretend now I'm going to have a coffee, a cup of tea, with your best friend, the one who gave you this lovely present, and I'm going to ask him, tell me the most beautiful thing about Bekin, in your opinion, and tell me something that he needs to improve on. What do you think your best friend would tell me?
I can tell you, he would tell you that I need to shout less and write a book. Or I need to leave this country if I'm so angry with what's happening in it. I know because he's told me that very recently.
Very good advice, very good advice. Okay, Bekin, let's play now Bekin and the Magic Box. You can ask me a question, okay? But right, you can ask me a question now.
I would like to ask you, do you ever think, or if you do, how often, what your life would be like if you didn't leave Brazil? And how much you miss it?
I suppose there's too many questions there. I'm always tricky. I'm a tricky little...
I love the question. I love the question. It's interesting you asking that.
I'm a foreigner myself, so I know how to ask questions to another foreigner.
I love the question. I love it. I think, Bekin, let me just go into my home now. Yay. my sweet home. I think my actually good point. Actually, my God, you put me in spot now. I think to be honest with you, I think if I would be in Brazil, like I think my life would be very ordinary. You know, a very very ordinary life, which is not wrong. You know, but I think
it's comforting.
Yeah, I think I wouldn't fit myself, and I think I would have other. I think I would live every day wondering how the world would
yes.
look like, what the world would be, because since I've been a little child, I always had this very adventure personality. I tell you something now. When I was 7 years old, like 6-7 years old, I was asking my dad to work. I went to on my school holidays. I remember all my friends, they were like, oh my God, I'm gonna go travel, I'm gonna do this. And I was literally asking my dad if I could work, if I could sell. In Brazil, we have this we have this little, like, little card where you just push the card to sell, like, ice cream in the street, like, you know, ice cream in the street.
Absolutely. I mean,
I was literally asking him. I said, Dad, can I do that? He was like, oh my God, no, you need to enjoy now your holidays. I was 7 years old. I was asking him to work. And I always had this personality of, like, you know, learning, growing, you know, get a better life and everything. So I think if I would be in Brazil, very good question. If I would be in Brazil, I think I would have an ordinary life, which is okay. Yeah. But yeah. At the same time as well, I would be wondering, like, how the world would be. Even more now with this technology, I would be like seeing, you know, this post and everything. I would be even more like, my God, how would
yeah,
I...
Yeah.
Yeah, I always have that anyway.
I think I could say exactly the same thing. I would probably be happy, but very ordinary life, always wondering, why am I here?
Yeah.
I would probably have 3 kids by now, a house and a lawn and a car and all that.
Yeah.
You know, all the rest of it. I have lucky to have such a nice family. I would just be pacing, seeing them a lot. And, you know, as you say, ordinary, probably quite happy, but always quite something missing, with this feeling of I'm missing out. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I completely resonate to what you just said.
Yeah, and the other question, how much I miss Brazil? There is another. Oh, that's my song.
I was going to do this earlier. I've got some special effects.
I'll tell you something. And the answer to your second question is about how much I miss Brazil. I'll tell you something now, Bekin. It's very good question. I left Brazil when I was 19 years old. I went to Portugal full of dreams on my own, full of, like, I want to get the world and everything. But, yeah. and I, And through this journey, since I left Brazil, I learned something as well, very, very important, and that is, you don't miss it, but you don't have it. So the thing is, I'll explain that.
Leave it, really.
I'll explain that.
You never quite leave your country completely, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I was about to say. So I learned that people, they ask me this question all the time, like, oh, you miss Brazil, blah, blah, blah. I said, of course I do miss Brazil. Of course I miss my family. I miss my, you know, my roots. I do, of course. Yeah. I do. But what you don't, like, overall in your life, what you don't have it is you don't miss it. For example, saying that, like, things around you, you know, if you don't have your family around you, of course you're always going to miss them, but not going to miss them like crazy or anything. You know, they are there.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
But part of me is always with me. I bring Kosovo with me wherever I go,
totally.
A little bit. So
of
it's
course.
Never really, I've never really left it. They think I've left it, but I never, in some ways, I've never left it.
You're never going to leave. You're never going to leave. You're going to be with you all the time.
No.
It's your roots.
No,
you know what
no,
I mean?
No.
Brazil, the same for me as well. And I'm very patriotic as well, actually. I'm very patriotic. I love being Brazil.
I'm not very patriotic, but...
I am always be. I think I love my country. I love my roots. I love where I come from, you know. And but I understand that I don't miss it because I don't have around me, so I don't miss it. But of course,
yeah.
I miss. You know, that's the fact.
Makes sense. Totally.
Nikki, did you have a good time?
I had a lot of time.
I'll tell you something now. First of all, I really, really enjoyed it. It's so nice to see you this way. I'm seeing right now. My God, I remember like talking to you in the past, and you always, I could see about to talk about politics in a very soft way, but to be honest, talking to you right now, as in this interview, I can see another person, and I can see a very interesting person. I can see someone who had a lot of point of views, have a lot of to share as well. And that's amazing. That's amazing to connect. I'm very glad that you accept my invitation because I've been talking for like 50 minutes. I've learned a few things because it's so nice to talk. As I said to you, I wish I had like 10. I knew 10% of your knowledge about politics in history because
Don't be modest.
But anyway, it's nice to see to connect with people and see people in a different way. I think it's so nice to connect with you and see how much you know. My God, it's amazing. My God, I could be another.
Not really that amazing. I just thought.
Come on, stop. No, come on. Don't be modest. We have our. You know, we always have our.
I'm just yup.
No, you're not. You know, you just be modest now. You know what you know, and I think it's just nice, just yourself, and it's nice to connect with you. It's nice to see, you know, another part of you, and it's really nice. I'm very grateful that you accept my invitation. Thanks so much.
Obrigado. To you too.
De nada. But before
you want to learn how to say thank you in Albanian?
Yes, please.
Faleminderit. It's a big one.
Thank you very much. But just before you go, Bekin, if you don't mind to share a positive quote, a positive message, something that inspires you in life.
Okay, I think I actually got one here I was reading earlier, and it says, the soul becomes dyed with the color of your thoughts. So have nice thoughts all the time, and the soul becomes just as nice and colorful.
And I'm going to ask a little favor now. Can you say that in your language or like similar to this quote?
Ah, okay. In Albanian.
Yes, please.
Shpirti ngjyroset me ngjyrën e mendimeve tuaja.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Vicky, it was a pleasure. Thank you so much for your time. Thanks for being so sweet and kind.
All right,
take
cheers.
Care. All the
bye,
best.
Bye.
Bye-bye. So, did you like the show? Don't forget to give a like, to share it, and also don't forget to subscribe to the channel. And if you'd like to be part of the show as well, first, subscribe to our channel, and after that, just go to our website, www.williamandthemagicbox.com, and send us a request saying why you'd like to be part of the show. And I see you there. Bye-bye, see you next time.